The Leadership Dojo, Build Your Foundation as an Exemplary Leader, by Richard Strozzi-Heckler. Narrated by Warywoda. Published by North Atlantic Books. Introduction. In 1985, after 16 years of working primarily with individuals, groups, and teaching professionals in a body-oriented psychology, I embarked in a new and unanticipated direction. I was selected to be part of a team that designed and conducted a bold and experimental training for the Army Special Forces. Our task was to increase the physical fitness, mental enhancement, and team cohesion of the Army Special Forces soldier. In the words of an officer who promoted the program, to train a holistic soldier. For 6 months, our team introduced 25 Green Berets to the newest methods of mind-body-spirit integration, including Aikido, other martial arts, nutrition, physical fitness training, stress reduction, meditation, warrior values, healing arts, team building, and communication skills. Codenamed the Trojan Warrior Project after the Homeric Greek soldiers who hid inside the belly of a wooden horse, this classified experiment produced positive, off-the-chart results in every area tested. Even though these men were the most highly trained soldiers in the U.S. Army, through this training, they radically improved their existing scores in the areas of physical fitness, mental alertness, team alignment, psychological balance, and moral integrity. The results of the Trojan Warrior Project made it apparent that the research I had been conducting in human performance for nearly 2 decades, with individuals and small groups, could be applied to teams and organizations with significant impact. At the conclusion of the program, when the men returned to their units, a curious phenomenon began to occur. Their commanding officers began reporting that the leadership skills of these men had dramatically improved. This was unexpected, in that the curriculum of the Trojan Warrior Project was not specifically designed to address leadership issues, but to improve individual and team performance. Soon, the Trojan Warrior Project began to be referred to as a leadership program in military circles. Subsequent programs with the Navy SEALs and Marine Corps produced similar comments from senior leadership. The practices the participants were doing created significant advances in their ability to lead, motivate, and mobilize their troops. Well, it made sense to me that the whole of one's life, professional and personal, would be positively affected by the cultivation of mind, body, and spirit. It aroused my curiosity as to why the project produced such positive results in the area of leadership. Soon I began to look more closely at the foundation of exemplary leadership and how it can be developed. When the project was declassified, I published the book In Search of the Warrior Spirit, chronicling this training and its impact on individual soldiers and the trainers, as well as turning a critical eye on the negative consequences of technology on traditional warrior values. This caught the attention not only of other branches of the military, but of the business world as well. The idea of training the whole person, coupled with the skillful action of the warrior, seemed to strike a chord in the business world. Keeping in mind that the book didn't make any claims about leadership, it wasn't long before I was asked to deliver adaptations of the program to the corporate world under the heading of Leadership and Management Training. This became a rich laboratory for exploring the relationship between leadership and mind-body-spirit training. I began by asking 3 questions of every team and organization I worked with. In an initial meeting with 40 senior executives at AT&T, for example, I proposed the question, "What does a leader do?" And I received 40 different answers. Responses included motivate others, execute plans, manage meetings, delegate responsibility, give orders, design strategies, produce organizational charts, make speeches, inspire, balance the budget, hire the right people, build alliances, mobilize skills, maintain an optimistic mood, and so on, until we had a whiteboard filled with the varied activities that took up an executive's time. This informal poll was duplicated in other companies, and inevitably it was the same. As many different answers as there were people. While all these activities were relevant to leadership, it was clear to me that performing these tasks didn't necessarily make a successful leader. I wanted to know who the person was behind these activities. What ground of being did he or she embody to successfully perform these actions? My second question, what are the character values most essential to exemplary leadership, produced an entirely different response. The answers fell into a consistent and predictable pattern. Whether the poll was taken with Chilean telecommunication executives, the senior leadership of the Marine Corps, 30-something technology entrepreneurs, European financiers, directors of nonprofits, U.S. senators, CEOs of Fortune 100 companies, or Canadian utilities executives, the same virtues unfailingly appeared. Honesty, accountability, integrity, vision, commitment, empathy, courage, trustworthiness, and self-control showed up time and again as the hallmarks of a leader. The literature and research on the character aspects of leadership also reflected this response. There seemed to be a universal consensus about the type of character values necessary for leadership and for leading an honorable life. Moreover, this list of values was hardly new. As far back as Plato and Thucydides in the West and the Indian epic Bhagavad-Gita and Buddhist text Abidharma in the East, these attributes have long been distinguished as the cornerstones of exemplary leadership and life. It seems that as long as human beings have recorded their history, there has been universal agreement about what kind of person is a successful leader. When I asked my final question, how do you teach these virtues? I was met with blank stares. It seemed I had reached the end of the trail. Most managers and leaders could say very little about how the character values of leadership are learned, and even among the brightest, the conversation descended into cliches. It's either there or it isn't. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. Leaders are born, not made. Presumably, this has something to do with the difficulty of measuring values, and business schools are notorious for demanding empirical measurements for everything. A typical refrain in the business world is, if it can't be measured, don't manage it. Nonetheless, the point is we can give examples of a leader's behavior, but nothing about how it's learned. Bookstores are filled with stories of great leaders and what they did in certain situations, but nothing about how they got there. There's precious little written about the how of leadership, and certainly no notable discourse representing it. It's as if we know what we're aiming for, and we know when it's present, but we don't know how to get there. This book is about learning the human side of leadership. It's informed by a lifelong passion for learning, and more than 3 decades of studying how people excel and achieve mastery. This hasn't been an academic pursuit of poring over texts, but working closely with leaders and leaders-to-be, in a wide variety of organizations. This includes the senior leadership of the Marine Corps, including the Commandant and Assistant Commandant, the command staff of the Special Operations Command, Navy admirals, a multitude of executives from large multinational corporations such as AT&T, Microsoft, Citibank, Pfizer, British Petroleum, Cisco, Hewlett-Packard, CMEX, and American Express, and national utilities, nonprofits, and small technological startups in the United States, Canada, the United Kingdom, Europe, Asia, and Latin America. Working in these different environments, I realized that leadership is something that can be learned, and it's generated in relationship with others. Exemplary leadership is not a thing. The correct genes, an appointment, a technique, or the chance of the draw that favors one individual over another. Exemplary leadership is a way of being, whether you're leading others or leading your own life. Leadership can be developed. It's a choice and an option. It's a skill and art that can be developed through commitment and practice. Leadership is about living our purpose while engaging deeply with others. The Leadership Dojo is a place, an operational distinction, a community, and a set of practices that produces exemplary leaders. In the Leadership Dojo, leaders and managers learn to embody and live their full potential. This book does not present a theory of leadership, a list of what leaders do, or a leadership style. While it's intended to be a thoroughly practical approach to leadership, it is neither a manual nor a recipe book that delivers tips and techniques for leadership in 10 easy lessons. Conversations about leadership tend to lean toward the banal. Leadership
is needed. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.